Did you see it, Doug? This big tick on above the foot.
Yes, sir. See that big tick on above the foot?
Look at it yet?
I looked at it, but I haven't studied it.
Oh, you mean for what?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh yeah. I've been reading that.
You waiting?
You what?
Yeah, we should set up a meeting with him.
Well, yes. What the hell am I doing my job?
Just if you want to meet with him when you're in Washington. Yeah, with Dick Hart. Whatever his name was. Steve Hart? Yeah.
He asked the delegation. What time's the flight today?
I think we leave it. 5:30 or 6.
That way you'd be right on the Capitol Hill.
I'll call the regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council to order and ask for the roll call.
Nancy Masterton?
Here.
Jane Amaral?
Here.
Penelope Carson?
Here.
Lester Jordan?
Here.
William Jordan?
Yeah.
Frank Littori?
Here.
Douglas Tinsman?
Here.
The seven councils are present.
Thank you, Debbie. First of all, I'd like to start out by congratulating the Cape Elizabeth boys basketball team who clawed their way to the top. They are the Class B state championship, and the town council is pleased and proud of them. We are preparing an appropriate recognition for a later time, but in the meantime, congratulations, boys. You did great. I'm going to ask for the a vote on the minutes of the meeting number 5 held in February 8th, 1988.
Madam Chairman, I move the minutes be approved as written.
Second. Any discussion? Councilor Tinsman.
Yeah, item 35 indicated a wrong vote. I just wanted to correct it. I was in the negative majority on item 35. Rather than to man the whole meeting, I thought we'd be.
Definitely a better way for me.
Okay. Do you have that, Debbie? Were you in the yes or no ranks?
No. I think the number's right. I think William Jordan was in the room. But I'm not sure.
I don't. Okay, I ain't going to go through it.
Okay.
It doesn't matter to me one way or the other. I thought I was on the scrap.
If there's no further discussion, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous.
Nobody abstained.
Reports and correspondence. Are there any reports or correspondence that you'd like to share? I have two announcements. One, that Councilor Bill Jordan has agreed to serve on the Cumberland County Jail Study Committee, and you will be hearing shortly from the Commissioner's Office. You have, good. Secondly, I would like to announce that nomination papers for council and school board are still available in the town office. And we urge anyone who's interested in running for either post to pick up your papers. I know we have a rather full slate for council. And what is the news on the state board? The school board.
Approximately 5 have taken out papers.
That's good, but there's always room for more.
Have taken out, they not all have been returned. There's still a couple questionable.
Thank you. I will now move to 3 public hearings, and we will do them one by one, but let me tell you what they are. First is a malt license for the Cape Elizabeth House of Pizza, which proposes to be located at the Pond Cove Shopping Center. Second is a hearing on the general assistance ordinance. Thirdly, on two sets of sewerage ordinance amendments. So we'll start with number one, the malt license for the Cape Elizabeth House of Pizza. Is there anyone representing the House of Pizza who would like to speak? Mr. Dukas, would you come up here to the podium, please, and identify yourself?
Madam Chairman, members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, my name is Andrew Dukas. I am an attorney from Portland representing the Macrises in their application that's before you now. The application is for a malt license beer to be consumed on the premises of what is going to be the Cape Elizabeth House of Pizza. You may be familiar with House of Pizza, as there are several of these restaurants currently in operation in Portland, South Portland, Falmouth, Wyndham, Norway, and we hope that we'll soon have one here in Cape Elizabeth. At the Pond Cove Center across the street. This operation is primarily for the sale of pizza and sandwiches. We believe 30 to 40% of the business will be takeout business. And my client would like to have beer available for those who stay to take their orders in-house, so to speak. And I'd be happy to address any questions that you have regarding the operation or how things will be served and so forth.
Thank you, Andy. If you just stay right there, we will take advantage of you in just a moment. But I wondered if there's anybody else in the audience who would like to speak on this issue. Mr. Adams.
My name is Henry Adams, resident of the town of Cape Elizabeth. Before you vote on this issue, I urge each of you to examine your conscience. This adds another outlet for alcoholic beverages in Cape Elizabeth. At a time when MAD, CAPASA, and a multitude of organizations are trying to reduce drunk driving. At a time when in May there will be a referendum question on the town council school board election to allow the Sunday sales of hard liquor in the neighboring IGA. At a time when we need to send positive signals to our young people that we are serious about drinking and driving. And at a time when the state legislature this very day is considering a bill to reduce the threshold of OUI from 0.1 to 0.08. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on this? At this point, does the council have any questions that they would like to address to Mr. Dukas? Councilor Carson.
I just wanted to ask, in the other House of Pizzas that are in the other towns, do they have malt licenses for those places? Or the ones they've requested them are?
No, they've never requested a malt license for any of them.
Oh, I see.
This is the first one.
Thank you.
Doesn't mean that they won't request them for those other ones, though.
Right.
any other questions of Mr. Dukas? Andy? I have one.
Excuse me.
Okay, Bill.
Okay, I don't have a question. I just want to give my opinion and comment on it. Is that allowable at this time?
Well, it's a public hearing.
Okay.
We will have our opportunity to discuss this. I was going to ask, are you going to be selling beer to take out?
Absolutely not. Beer will be sold for consumption on the premises, either by the glass or by a pitcher for a group of people. The consumption is going to take place immediately in front of the people operating the restaurant. There'll be a kitchen area, an ordering area, and the tables directly in front. Anyone who's drinking beer on the premises will be observed at all times. This is not going to become a drinking place. Beer will only be served when people come in for a meal. The owners are not going to condone people who come in and ask for a pitcher of beer and just drink the beer. That's going to be discouraged. The setup of the restaurants, if you're familiar with any of the House of Pizzas, is a very open area in the front with the a long counter towards the back. And it's very conducive to seeing exactly what's going on and who's drinking what. If the council has a fear that a person can come in and buy a pitcher of beer, take it into the far corner and distribute it to minors or so forth, that wouldn't be happening in this type of circumstance. The closest thing I can relate to this type of operation being would be, for instance, a Pizza Hut family type of operation, not as large.
Councilor Torrey.
Yes, Andy, I was wondering, is there going to be waitress service at this, or is this strictly go to the counter, pick it up, and then bring it back?
I think it's no waitress. It's basically you come up and give your order and go back, and they call you up for it.
Mm-hmm. Now, are you familiar offhand with the law in terms of must the person be 21 years old that serves the beer? I'm just wondering if there ever could conceivably be caught where the only person in there is like a 17 or an 18-year-old, and there's certain pressures to sell beer, you know, uh-huh. by a minor that's behind the counter.
I know there is a applicable law for minors, and I do have it here. I can tell you that. If you can give me 3 seconds. Has been amended so many times that it's kind of a hodgepodge of laws. Okay.
Well, that could be something that you could have for us. It's going to come back to us, it sounds like, if it goes to another board, and then we'll be voting on it again, I assume. So that's one question that I will raise again, if you could.
I'll work an answer up to that and either provide it to you in written form or at another proceeding.
Okay, that would be great.
Okay.
I guess the only other question I have is I'm a little curious as to why this is the first outlet that's considering beer. I mean, is it being projected to go into the other? I mean, there's a number of things that are already operating. Maybe it would be a little more comfortable if there was a history, but why is this the first chosen, I wonder?
Well, the others have evolved over a period of time. It's just not something that has come up. And like I mentioned before, it may come up and may be integrated into those other ones. Actually, I think the owners see this as the ideal place to try it. Small, controlled, easily managed.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions of Mr. Dukas? And thank you very much, Andy. Nice to see you again.
Well, thank you.
If there are no other comments or questions, I will declare this public hearing closed and move on to number 2, which is the General Assistance Ordinance. Is there anyone who wishes to speak on this? There being none, I declare this public hearing closed. Number three are two sets of sewerage ordinance amendments. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to comment? If not, then I will declare this public hearing closed. And we will move on to item number 48, to consider a request from Georgius K. Gregorius, Stella and Efrosini Makris for a full-time malt license for the Cape Elizabeth House of Pizza. I want to say before we start discussing this that it is my understanding that this will be a change in use, and therefore the proposal will have to go through both the Planning Board and the Zoning Board of Appeals. Michael? Did you have something that you wanted to comment on?
Yes, I just wanted to make a comment on, I don't know whether we should do it before it goes to the boards, but I think the proper way to handle it is going to go start with the Planning Board, because I think it's a change in use there. And I just want to say that I've had a couple of calls about being opposed to the beer part of the pizza joint. And I myself is very much opposed to the beer part of it. And I would vote in favor of just the pizza joint when it ever comes back to here, but I would say right up front I'd be against the beer part of it. Too close to the schools, and I don't think the town needs a pizza joint serving beer. They might need a pizza joint, but I don't think they need one serving beer, and I think they're pretty hard to police once they get in the community. Thank you.
I just think it's kind of putting the cart before the horse for us to be dealing with this tonight, because we're not sure what the Planning Board or Zoning Board will do with this item when it comes before them. So I really think it's inappropriate for us to be voting on whether they should have a malt license or not before we know whether they're going to be allowed to operate as a restaurant or not. So I guess I would like to move that we table this for the time being until it's had proper review by the appropriate boards.
Seconded.
No discussion on a tabling motion. All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 41, to consider a new general assistance ordinance. Michael?
Just very briefly, the general assistance ordinance is as prepared in a draft by the Maine Municipal Association. If it's adopted tonight, it would govern the way we provide general assistance to needy persons in the community. It runs 27 pages long, and I would suggest, unless you want it read, that you make a motion to suspend the rules to do away with its reading.
So moved. That would suspend the rules.
All those in favor? All right, the reading of the ordinance has been waived. A further motion is in order.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Latour.
I move adoption of the General Assistance Ordinance dated November 1987.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Item number 50, to consider a proposed amendment to the sewerage ordinance which would remove antiquated language. Councillor Jordan, who is chairman of the ordinance committee, will make a brief presentation.
The language here that we are about to vote on was put into the ordinance back when they put the moratorium on the treatment plant in Spoink and the Hunts Point. And now with a new treatment plant in operation, it's not needed any longer. Now, I don't know whether you want me to read all this?
Mm-hmm.
I suppose so. But you suspended the rules on the other one. Okay.
To amend the sewer ordinance by removing the following language from 15-1-4A and B and 15-1-7A and B. Notwithstanding any provision in this charter to the contrary, there shall be no further connections to the municipal sewers served by the Spoink and the Hunts Point running tide treatment plants until such time as the town hall has taken the necessary steps as determined by the vote of the town council to alleviate the existing overloading conditions of those plants. In light of the requirements of the State of Maine Department of Environmental Protection, the superintendent may grant exceptions to this suspension of a connection only when the building inspector shall have determined that the new connection being requested would meet the following requirements. Number one, the structure to be served was built prior to December 10, 1980. Number two, any existing subsurface system is malfunctioning and the replacement system varies of the State of Maine Department of Human Services would be required for a replacement system. Number three, the new sewer connection would be required the extension of a public sewer revised 8-9-83 and 10-24-83 and 3-12-86. They were busy right here. I move that we adopt the changes.
Second. Any discussion? Councilor Jordan, last adjourn.
We're just one little minor. Number one, under that, you've got build, as you should be built prior. I don't know whether that makes a difference or not.
That's a typo. Any further discussion? Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor of adoption of the ordinance change? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 51. To consider a proposed amendment to the sewerage ordinance which would permit homes built prior to December 10, 1980 to connect to the municipal sewer under certain conditions, regardless of whether or not the lot has frontage on a public sewer line. Councilor Jordan?
Thank you. This ordinance, what it does is, if you have a home and it doesn't front on a public road, which is a requirement in the sewer ordinance, that you get the proper easements across other properties and you would be able to hook into the sewer. The recommended motion is to amend section 15-1-4D and 15-1-7B by adding the following language: notwithstanding any other provision in this chapter to the contrary, the superintendent may grant a connection permitted to any resident without frontage on a public sewer line when the following requirements are met. The structure, number one, the structure to be served was built prior to December 10, 1980. I don't know what happens. We got to look at that, what happens in 81. Number two, any existing subsurface system is malfunctioning and a replacement system varies of the State Department of Human Services would be required for a replacement system. Number three, the applicant shall pay the application, applicable connection fees and all costs associated with the connection. And number four, the applicant shall provide to the town a copy of the sufficient deeds filed in the Cumberland County Register of Deeds, which gives the applicant the right to install, maintain, and replace any portion of the proposed building sewer and or sewer extension that would be on the land owned in part or in total by a party other than the applicant or the town itself. That's it. I recommend the adoption.
Second. Are you moving that?
That's I'm recommending the adoption, yes. I move the motion.
We second. Have a second. Any questions or discussion? favor of adoption, signify. Opposed, it's unanimous. Item number 52, to consider the preliminary report of the Harbor Advisory Committee. And I see in the audience the chairman of that committee, Bruce Coggeshall.
No fishing stories.
What's
that?
No fishing stories.
No fishing stories. Well, you know, when I tell people I'm on the Cape Elizabeth Harbor Advisory Committee, they ask me where Cape Elizabeth Harbor is. I tell them that we got a grant from the state to help us find out. It is a pleasure to appear before the council tonight and report to you on the doings of the Harbor Commission. I want to thank the council for appointing me to this and to Penny Carson for convincing me to do it. And I must tell you, it's a very interesting and lively committee where everybody's views are expressed and a lot of differing views are expressed and discussed. I'm fortunate to have on the committee three members of the council, Frank LaTorre, Bill Jordan, and Doug Tinsman, because I think we've been able to act pretty much unanimously so far, and so I'm generally assured of three votes on the council if votes are needed. The other members of the committee are listed on the front page of the report which we've submitted, and we have another person that regularly comes to our meetings and offers helpful suggestions, and that is George Knowles, who I see in the audience tonight. As you, I believe you've all got a copy of the report which was submitted last week, and it is a preliminary report. I'd like to review it very briefly tonight and then answer any questions that anybody may have. As you can see from reading the report, the committee's focus to date has been on Kettle Cove, where we're grappling with the issue of how to better manage and better utilize this important resource. To date, we've dealt almost exclusively with what I refer to as land side as opposed to water side issues, although we have dealt a little bit in the report with some mooring issues. We're continuing to work on the water side issues. We've assigned our consultants, governmental services, to deal primarily with those issues, with the mooring issues and the problem of perhaps finding an alternate site for a boat launching facility. In dealing with the land side issues, we've identified four basic problems that we've tried to deal with and come up with solutions to. These are the problem of competing demands on what facilities are there, the availability of a launch area for pleasure boats, the whole parking problem, and fourth, a general problem of supervision and enforcement of the regulations that we have and hope to have. Touching first on the problem of competing uses, we have the traditional use of the area called Stump Cove by commercial fishermen who have to get their boats down and their boats back and the fish out, and they complain that the pleasure boaters are insensitive to the needs of the fishermen, block their access, park where the fishermen need to park, and generally get in their way. And we have the pleasure boaters saying that there isn't any place else in Cape Elizabeth to put a boat, and we've got to be able to get in at Kettle Cove also. We think we've come up with a solution to that. The launching at Kettle Cove has traditionally been in two places. Stump Cove, which is the gravelly area as you go in on the right, has been used mostly by fishermen. For a number of years, smaller pleasure boats have actually been launched from the beach. The town owns a small access down to the beach, and cars have driven down there and launched the boats. We think that the Stump Cove area ought to be reserved during hours when fishermen are typically using it exclusively for the fishermen, and the pleasure boaters ought to be directed to launch their boats from the beach. We've recommended that the town institute a permit system where the residents of the town can get an annual permit to launch a boat at Kettle Cove. The pleasure boating permit would entitle him to go across the town access and launch his boat from the beach. The commercial fisherman's permit would permit the commercial fisherman to launch his boat at Stump Cove and to park his vehicle and his trailer there at Stump Cove, where he can be close to the access. We've recommended that the town hire an attendant to be there during the summer months to direct the boating traffic, to assure that people that are launching boats do in fact have permits, to cut down on the general parking on the beach, and making sure that nobody goes on the beach unless he has one, has a permit, and two, has a boat on his car or on a trailer attached to his car. We're recommending that the town charge a fee of $10 for these permits, that a daily permit be available for non-residents, which they would probably pick up at the public safety building, and that a charge of $2.50 be made for that permit. We think that in separating this use, a lot of the complaints that we have from the fishermen will be eliminated, and that it'll make a more efficient use of this facility. The parking problem at Kettle Cove is threefold. One is the parking in the Stump Cove area, which I've already talked about. As I say, we want to restrict that to fishermen so that the fishermen are not blocked. The other problem is the general parking on the beach. One of the members of the committee brought in some pictures of, I guess, last summer, when there were many, many cars parked on the beach, basically beachgoers who, I guess, are going in there instead of going into Crescent Beach. And the third problem is just an overall crowding of the parking lot. The lot gets full and people park on the grass, on the curb, wherever there's a little bit of vacant space of land. So as I say, we're suggesting at Stump Cove the parking be limited to fishermen, nobody be permitted on the beach unless they're launching a boat, and we're recommending that as far as the parking lot itself is concerned, there simply be a clearer delineation as to where parking is supposed to be, and then enforcement of those regulations. On the enforcement issue, we think that the attendant that we're recommending be hired could be authorized to enforce the parking regulations and issue parking tickets for cars that are improperly parked. He would also be the person that directs the boat traffic and sees that the people go in the proper places. One of the issues that we're struggling with right now, and which we haven't cleared up entirely, is the issue of how much the town can do down there and how much we need to get permission from the state for, since this is a state-owned facility. I talked today with Herb Hartman, who is the director of the Bureau of Parks and Recreation, and he is coming to our next meeting in April to discuss some of these issues with us. I think that most of the issues can be resolved as soon as we understand what each of us wants. But they've suggested to us that maybe there ought to be a gate, maybe there ought to be a chain across the town access. Maybe we should charge for parking down there the same as they charge in Crescent Beach. And I think that the committee is generally opposed to those types of things, and we have to work these out with Mr. Hartman. One thing that Mr. Hartman told me today that's very interesting is that there are some state funds available for land acquisition and boat facility construction. One of the things we've asked the consultants to do is to look for alternate sites. There doesn't seem to be enough room, or it doesn't seem to be an adequate area at Kettle Cove to have any more extensive use than we have right now. And if we're going to put a boat launching facility somewhere, Kettle Cove is probably not the place. We've asked the consultants to explore alternate locations in the town. Herb Hartman tells me that there is money available to acquire land and build facilities. If the consultants come back with another viable location, I think we'd be asking the Bureau of Parks and Recreation to make some of that money available that he says is there. That's part of the long-range work that we're doing. The short range is the recommendations we made in this report, hopefully things that can get implemented to take care of the problems at Kettle Cove during the summer. That's about all of the report I intended to review with you tonight. I'd be happy to answer any questions anybody may have. Jane.
First of all, Bruce, how easy or difficult is it to launch a boat from the beach?
It's done a lot, Jane. In fact, some of the fishermen, in fact, launch their dinghies from the beach. You can't launch a big boat, and there are not a lot of big pleasure boats that go in there. But we're talking about, small outboards, sunfish, board sailors, this type of thing. It's really not any more difficult than I'm told than launching out of Stump Cove.
Okay. The other issue, which I wonder if you've discussed, and you probably have, but how are you going to define commercial fishermen as far as getting the permits? Because if you're going to make a distinction between only the commercial fishermen using Stump Cove and anyone else who goes fishing for pleasure or any other kind of launching of a boat for pleasure, as being able to only use the beach, I would think that it would be very helpful to have a definition of what a commercial fisherman.
We're hoping that you do that when you do your ordinance.
It would be nice to have a recommendation, though.
Yeah, we've talked about that, Jane, and I'm not sure we've come up with a completely satisfactory definition, but recognize that is one of the things we've got to do. There are people that go out of there and fish at night for pleasure. Mm-hmm. And those aren't the types of fishermen that we're talking about. Right. We're talking about commercial fishermen.
The state license.
And I guess yeah, there's probably a state fishing license.
Yes, and for everything.
For commercial fishermen?
Of all kinds.
Yeah. And so
how much is that license? I mean, it might be worth it to someone, yeah, if it's relatively inexpensive to get a license just so they can launch.
Well, I don't think you're going to see a lot of people. I think if you have the two areas designated, I don't think that one is hugely preferable over the other. And I don't think someone with a small pleasure boat is going to go to that trouble just so we can go out of Stump Cove. I think it's mainly a function of saying to people, this is one area for these types of boats and this is an area for another types of boats, and just trying to separate the two functions.
I have a question, Bruce. How many commercial fishermen are we talking about?
I'm not sure. There are probably a dozen or so that go out of Kettle Cove. Do you think that's right, Bill?
A lot more than that.
I think there'd be more than that. There'd be that many maybe in Kettle Cove area, but off the beach, I think during the summer you would find a dozen that go there.
Go off the beach too?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know if we've really nailed the number down, but the principal concern has been for the commercial fishermen has been those that go out of Stump Cove having their access and their parking blocked. And I gather from what we've heard is that the ones that go off the beach are generally smaller dinghy fishers or skiff fishers.
Well, if we are talking about 24, even if they all went out of Stump Cove, as I guess your recommendation is.
No, that's not the recommendation. The recommendation is that that only fishermen can go out of Stump Cove, but fishermen can also go off the beach.
Okay. But say even 12 of them go out of Stump Cove, and you say that they can park their cars in that gravelly area, which is sort of a launching area.
Well, they park off to the side.
Where do you mean they would park?
Well, in the gravelly area. I think the, if they all came in there at the same time, there isn't room for all of them to park. But the, if we limit it to just those people, then there are only 12 people competing for those spaces instead of the 200 people that come down and park all over the parking lot. And that's the reason for doing it. And the fishermen are a little more sensitive to the needs of the fishermen and tend not to block each other the way the general public does.
Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I have a few questions, I guess. I was wondering, though, first, are you going to let the general public
speak before Bruce is there, go ahead with your question.
First thing I have is more or less a statement. One of the first things you said when you came up to the podium was, people ask you, where's the harbor in Cape Elizabeth? I just want to make this statement that we had one of the first harbors in the United States. That's Richmond Island Harbor, started in 1607. And it's very well known throughout the United States. That's a stopping off place for all the yachts coming up in the summer. The Richmond Island Harbor is actually pretty well known. But some of the questions I have, I'm wondering how we can adopt this tonight when we don't know what the state will allow us to do. Are they going to allow us to charge a fee on state property, I wonder?
Well, we've had that discussion, and we've got to pursue it further. But I think the fee is going to be a fee that's charged for going over the town property. It's not really a parking fee.
But Stump Cove, you're talking about a fee there for the fishermen. That's not going over town property.
Well, the permit, Lester, would permit the fishermen to go over the, not only to go to Stump Cove, but to go over the town access as well. And that's what we're charging for.
So that's how you get around the state?
We think so.
If the state says no, then we're just going to say that's a permit to go over our right away.
That's correct.
The other question I had is, I see in here that it recommends hiring an attendant. Do you have any idea what the attendant is going to cost us for the summer? Somebody? And where the funds are coming from?
For the remaining portion of this fiscal year, it'd be approximately $1,100 on a full schedule. If this was implemented, it would be $4,752.
And where would the money come from?
General fund, offset by some of the fees that would be collected.
We didn't have anything like that in the budget this last year, and we don't know what the Finance Committee is going to do at budget time this year, right?
That's correct.
I'd like to be able to turn it over to the general public, unless to maybe see if there's any comments. And then
Chancellor has a question. Or a comment.
I just had a comment first of all to answer Les's question. Tonight, this is just a report for us to accept the report, not the recommendations. I would certainly think that even though it does say adopt the recommendation,
well, that's
merely
so
to accept the report, but we do have to start thinking about a time frame in which we should adopt some of these recommendations, because the summer season and the problems that we had last year are going to be right with us if we don't do something positive. And I think these trial steps are just that. They're to determine how well it works this summer, and our final report would indicate what programs and what sort of implementations we'll need for the long range, working with the state and also working for our own best interest. But I would like to ask the chairman of the committee if you wanted to hit upon, or whether the manager thinks it's necessary to talk about the mooring situation and the mooring permits and the costs associated with that.
I'd be happy.
That ought to be in the same period or time frame as
I'd be happy to address that briefly if the chairman would care to have me do so. As part of our the one water related water side recommendation that we've made is that mooring that a system of charging mooring fees be adopted, with the thought that this would cover the cost of the town of providing the harbor master and the services provided by the harbor master. Our recommendation is that the fees be established at for a two year mooring permit. $25 for residents and $100 for non-residents. Just for your information, the state statute that governs this type of thing lets you charge non-residents up to five times what a resident is charged. One of the tasks that we've asked the consultants to undertake is to provide do a mooring study and provide a mooring plan at Kettle Cove to see whether any more moorings can be put out there, and if so, where would they best be located. That is currently underway. The fishermen that are on the committee have said on a number of occasions they don't think a lot more moorings can be put there, and they're probably correct. Anything else you wanted to discuss on that?
No, I just think that it's important that those two go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Because unless it talks about the permitting and with the commercial fishermen, the moorings have a strong role in determining who's a commercial fisherman and who needs to use Stump Cove.
Yeah.
And that there is a difference between Crescent Beach and Stump Cove, but those are spelled out more clearly when the mooring plan and situation comes into play with the whole management.
The mooring fees also. I know Lester was concerned about the effect of this on the general fund. To date, the town has received no revenues at all from the moorings. And there are, in the whole town, I think there is something like 200 moorings, approximately. Is that the number that Steve Jordan gave us?
90.
100.
90.
Is it 190 more?
190.
Okay.
He knows.
Okay. So we've got 100 moorings that'll be paying a fee, or 90 moorings.
Bruce, you say you have a meeting with Herb Hartman on the 9th?
On April 7th, I think it is.
April 7th.
Yeah.
Do you expect that you will be able to iron out with the state the issues on which you sort of disagree, such as a gate, a chain, and parking fees? Do you think that you're going to be able to iron that out in that one meeting?
I doubt that we can iron out all of the issues, but I certainly anticipate that we can address them all and iron out some of them.
Well, I think...
And I don't know which one.
Concern has been shown here by at least one member of the council that we should be looking towards the coming season, and I was just
That's
trying
correct.
To get some kind of a feel as to whether all these issues can be ironed out.
They won't, I don't think they can be all ironed out in one meeting, but some of the issues I don't think we need to iron out in order to implement the things that we've suggested for this summer. For example, if we can't agree on whether there should be a gate or not, there won't be a gate, and so that one doesn't get resolved and it doesn't cause any problems. If we can't agree on whether there should be a chain across the town access, then we don't have a chain. And these are things I think that we won't agree on. I think the important things for us to agree on are, can we segregate Stump Cove, which is owned by the state? And can we put up a sign there that says, parking for commercial fishermen only, boat launching for commercial fishermen only? I think we can get an answer out of Herb Hartman on that fairly quickly. He's already indicated that that maybe we can work something out along these lines, as long as we've got an alternate facility for the pleasure boaters can get their boats in. And I talked to him about that same issue again today, and I think that the important issues can get resolved in a in a meeting, or if not on the 7th, in another meeting between Herb and Michael and me.
Are there any other questions? Council Torrey.
Yes, I would just add to what Bruce has said, that basically we worked very hard to try to get you something this evening. As I'm sure as you all read through it, you could see there's certain issues that have to be addressed again this summer that we don't want to see roll past another summer, which is why we worked to this deadline to get to the March 14th meeting with these recommendations. Now, if we decide to accept this, set it to a public hearing, we could still implement things by the summer. But there was a real strong consensus from fishermen, everyone, windsurfers, you name it, that we can't let another summer go by without trying something. And especially in areas that I'm very concerned about, such as the parking, which is just organized chaos down there now. The attendant and proper signage that's set here and proper enforcement can really go a long way to alleviate that and make it an even nicer facility. So I think it's a very positive report, which has the basic seven things that Bruce outlined, and I hope that we can adopt it, get some input, and yet be able to implement, even though there'll be certain cost factors, in order to make a facility of ours even more smooth flowing this summer. I just wanted to give that perspective as to why we're here tonight and why I think it's important that we move on some of these things before the summer. Thank you.
Councilor Tinsman.
I'd just like to move that we receive this report and set it for public hearing on April 11th, together with the mooring plan and fee structure as outlined earlier, so that those issues become available for public comment at the April 11th meeting.
Second. Councilor Jordan.
Well, accepting or receiving makes some of my questions go away rather than adopt. So that satisfies that. But I would also like to throw out, if you're having a meeting with Hartman, the possibility of, I don't know whether anyone thought of this or not, but the possibility of building a road ramp, or if that's what I'm calling it. It's more of a ramp or way to get down the beach south of Stump Cove. If you could get four-wheel drive vehicles down there easily, I think that would open up a lot more launching sites.
Down in the area called John Cove?
Yeah, correct. Yeah. I know that there may be some stipulations with the conservation easement that was placed on that state land, but yeah. If we could get an ideal road down onto that beach.
One of the things I hadn't mentioned tonight is that one of the other competing uses of this facility is by scuba divers, and that is the area typically used by the scuba divers. And
I realize that
it's difficult to
scuba divers could go most anywhere. They don't need to launch a boat, and so you could put them in another area. And if this was an ideal or the only ideal spot in the whole Cape Coast to launch a boat, if you could get down on it, I think you could find another cove for that.
Well, I think it's certainly worth looking at. I agree.
Michael.
The motion that was made referenced a mooring plan for a public hearing next month. There won't be a mooring plan available as of that date.
The mooring schedule.
Mooring fees. Mooring fee schedule.
Any other questions or comments? The motion.
I would just like to make a motion, might help Lester a little bit.
A comment
that might help him out a little bit. We did put some money into having the police or what have you down there this year to help clear up the problem. So I think as a member of the committee also that this is something that's needed badly. And I think that maybe we haven't thrown out the issue. We couldn't get a few bucks out of the state. So we may not have all the burden of police in the part that's supposed to be their responsibility.
I agree with you.
Are you ready for the vote?
May we have it read, because there is a little confusion.
The motion?
Yes.
Debbie.
Motion by Councilor Tinsman to receive the report of the Harbor Advisory Committee and to set the public hearing at the Town Council meeting on April 11th, 1988, 7:30 p.m. at the Town Hall, to include a mooring fee schedule to be available for public comment.
All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous.
Well, one of my other questions was, are you going to open this up to the public at all for maybe comments that would help us on that? Or
well,
that
we will be having a public hearing.
That's going to be saved for that night?
Yeah. Councilor Carson.
I just wanted to say my appreciation to Bruce Crouch for chairing this committee. It was a committee that charges from the council kept coming as the committee was meeting, and how nice it is to have a citizen in the community like Bruce and many other citizens who respond to the council by putting in a lot of hours to accomplish something in a short period of time, and I really appreciate making one phone call and getting a positive answer.
Thank you, Bruce. Item number 53, to consider a request from I. Allen Balfour to rezone part of the Broad Cove subdivision from RP zone to RA zone. Do we have a representative of Mr. Balfour here? Mr. Dale.
Can I say one thing to me?
Michael.
Just for the public's information, this item before you tonight, you cannot take any final action on it. The only action that really can be taken is to refer it to the planning board. The appropriate fee has been paid and all other requirements in order to have that happen. Thank you.
Mr. Dale?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Members of the council, my name is William Dale. I'm an attorney in Portland. I'm here this evening on behalf of Allen Balfour, who has requested a zone change to the town zoning map to change a portion of his property in the Broad Cove area from resource protection to Residence A. I have submitted with my zone change application a letter describing the background of this request and the reason for it, along with a map showing the property in question. I'd be pleased, Madam Chairman, to run through that again or simply to answer questions as you prefer.
Since this is going to be referred to the planning board and will come back to the council at a later date with their recommendation, I think we could probably save time and our questions in one fell swoop. If that's all right with the other members of the council.
Madam Chairman, I just would say again, perhaps as I've said at other times, I don't quite understand this process. When things come to us, and maybe even more than I don't understand, I don't like this process. I certainly can't question with the many, many questions that I have tonight, because it still has to go to the planning board, and yet it may appear to some members of the public that what we just do is automatically send these. And if that's the case, then I just soon step out of this step of the process. Under what set of circumstances, I guess I would ask, would it be inappropriate to send, or would it be possible not to send it to the planning board? I get a little frustrated at this particular process, which makes no sense to me, because I don't like anywhere where I see in government what I would call rubber stamping or just automatic. And that seems to be the case in case members of the public, which it seems to be a fairly controversial issue and doesn't see us questioning, it has to automatically go somewhere, and I just need to express my dismay at this particular process. So that's what I will say. I see people shaking their heads yes, so maybe other people feel that way too.
Councilor Ammo?
Is there an answer to Frank's question? Does this have to automatically be referred to the planning board, or do we have a choice?
Michael?
The ordinance requires you to refer to the planning board.
Councilor Ammo?
Then, I do see several people from the neighborhood here, and I do think the fact that they came and are concerned that they ought to have a chance to address any issues that they might want to raise at this point, because it is on our agenda. And I would like to hear from anybody from the public that has something to say on this item.
Is there anyone from the public who wishes to?
You didn't let anybody speak on the features.
Who wishes to speak on this item? Yes, sir. Can you stay there, Mr. Dale? Okay?
I will.
I don't see why you let one of them talk.
My name is Edward Perry. My family's lived at 10 Pine Ridge Road for 17 years. I don't know, since I don't know what the proposal is, I don't exactly know what I'm speaking to, but I have an idea what the proposal is. My feeling is that after being in Broad Cove for 17 years and watching it grow and watching over 200 houses being packed in on half-acre lots. There's no open space left. Every lot is filled now. There's no place for children to go and play. There's no place for people to walk. The RP zone is the only place left that's designated so far to be left as an open natural area. It's not a particularly well-suited area to recreation because it's so wet, but it's the only place where people can go and see wildlife and cross-country ski or walk. And I feel as developmental pressure increases around Cape Elizabeth, we become in danger of losing what makes Cape Elizabeth attractive in the first place. As it becomes more profitable for rural areas to become housing developments, these rural areas are going to be gone, and these little RP zones that have been zoned for non-building are going to be very important. That's just my feeling on the whole situation. I think there are other people who feel the same way. I think if we had gotten, we'd had a little more notice on it, I think would have had more people here, although like Mr. Latore says, I don't think we're really sure of how the process works. We just heard that Mr. Balfour read in the paper that Mr. Balfour was coming before the town council to ask for a zoning change, and I talked to Ms. Amaral on the phone about it, and she said it would probably be referred to the planning board, but we wanted to come and see the process work anyway. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any? Yes, sir.
I'm Julian Coles, and I've lived in Broad Cove for 12 years. And I guess I echo the sentiments of Mr. Perry in a couple of areas, and I'd like to reinforce them if I could. First of all, understanding the process becomes more and more difficult. And as much as we try and stay involved, what I don't understand is why we weren't notified. I thought we were under, at least I was under the assumption that were something going on contiguous to our land, that any thought of changing a zone or something would require that we be notified. And we have been notified in the past, and we were not notified in this case, which concerns me because it isn't possible to stay up with everything. And the second is the recurring nature of this particular item, which seems to have come back in one form or another like an insidious cancer cell. It seems to reappear in another form. And yet the water table remains above ground level. The nature of the land is well documented and well observed by everybody that have taken the time to walk through. And I know many of the planning board have walked through this when the road question came up a year ago. And it was put in without an approval. And birch trees were bulldozed and fill was put in. And it just seems to me that it becomes almost impossible as a person who just goes about his business and tries to live a fairly informed life to keep up with all of this. And when do we say enough is enough, and you can't, when can we feel confident as citizens that this thing isn't going to creep up on us and change without our notice? And these, I think, are the questions like Mr. Latore was asking. I mean, when is it appropriate for you guys to put the final stamp on this thing and say enough is enough? We've got other things to do besides reconsider this every year. So that's my concern.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Michael, did you want to respond to the notification?
Yeah, just very briefly. when it's referred to the planning board always does send out notices notifying of their public hearings. When it comes back to the town council, if the town council at that point has, I'd have to recheck the rules. I'm not sure if they can defeat it if they wish to, or whether or not they have to call a public hearing. But if a public hearing is called, then notices are sent out to abutters. Usually at the first referral stage, notices are not sent out. I think, you know, I've heard complaints too from the property owner that the land was rezoned without notification to them. And, you know, at this point, I think everyone is looking for due process on this particular issue.
Is there there any discussion among the counselors? Anybody else? Mr. Dale?
If I could just respond briefly so we don't come off as the heavy on this, and if I could respond to Councilor Torrey's concern, the procedure set out in the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance is very similar, if not identical, to that of all the other communities in Greater Portland, that proposed amendments initiated by property owners to the local zoning map comes first to the legislative body and, as a matter of routine, gets referred to the planning board, which holds a public hearing, notifies the neighbors, makes a recommendation, then brings it back to the town council or city council. Again, if a public hearing is going to be held, the neighbors are notified so that nobody gets left out of the process. And I don't want any of the neighbors to think that we left them out of the process. We're following your ordinance, and that's what it provides. And again, yours is pretty typical of the others in Greater Portland. Other than to say, usually town councils don't even allow as much discussion as is here tonight just because neighbors haven't been notified. But I checked with your town manager's office and was told that the process was to at least be here tonight, so that's why we're here. We are very pleased to notify the neighbors when it's time to go to the planning board, and I'm sure they'll all be there, and I'm sure they'll all be here when we come back to the town council. And the other comment, if I could make, Madam Chairman, is simply that this is the first zone change request that I'm aware of for this 13-lot proposal, so I'm not sure it's fair to characterize this as a repeated attempt to come back here. But just so everybody understands, now that the matter is out in the open a little bit, Mr. Balfour owns 13 remaining lots from his original Broad Cove subdivision. It has been rezoned resource protection so that it can't be developed for single-family houses. He would like it rezoned so they could. I understand the neighbors are opposed to that, but that's the project. So there's no misunderstanding as to anything terrible that we might be proposing there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Jordan.
I just would like to respond to Councilor Torrey's comment about the process. The Ordinance Committee looked at this at our last meeting and wanted to know if there's some way that we couldn't shorten up the procedure and whether it'd be legal or wouldn't be legal, and possibly the council and the planning board would hold their public hearing together, but it's nothing that will be affected at this juncture. It's something that will be taken up in the future, and we'll certainly look into it.
Councilor Lester,
turn. I'd like to move that we refer the request from I. Alan Belfour for a zone change to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous.
Madam Kim. For the benefit of the public, there are two planning board meetings in March on the 15th and the 22nd. It will not be on either agenda. So probably the first time it will come up at the planning board agenda is on the third Tuesday in the month of April.
Thank you.
Item number 54, to consider a report from the CATV Advisory Board. Let's see, is the chairman of that board here tonight?
No.
No? Michael?
You have before you a report from the Cable TV Committee. What this recommends is a number of things. One is that we begin to pay the personnel who up to this point have very generously volunteered their time to broadcast town council, school board, and planning board members, that the pay be set at $4.50 per hour, and that it include approximately 55 public meetings per year. Secondly, the committee recommended the purchase of a piece of equipment that will enable the tapes to begin automatically and to return to the bulletin board automatically. This will allow broadcasting of a lot more programs than are now currently being broadcast. Committee also had certain budget recommendations which do not affect the action you're being requested tonight. They asked me to meet with the superintendent to discuss the school board, school department's use of equipment. They asked the me to write to Public Cable to insist that the town have override capabilities on its own channel. This has been taken care of, and Public Cable was very prompt in response to the request of the committee. They also, one item they didn't recommend but included in the report is a suggestion that the chairman's spot on the podium have a new adjustable neck microphone in order to ensure that whoever is chairman of all the different committees being broadcast, our voice projects.
Soft-spoken.
Soft-spoken. The cable TV coordinator spoke to me today and strongly encouraged the town council to not only approve these recommendations, but also to add the color monitor at this time. Apparently, which is a $369 item, apparently there's a problem with moving it from editing to moving it for regular broadcast, and it would greatly enhance the quality of the broadcast if you did all these things. Instead of raising $1,500, you raised $1,869. Thank you.
Councilor Tor.
Yes, in looking over the report, there seems to be a discrepancy in the amount of money asked for and the equipment that was listed in the report. Something else was left off. It must have been, was it the $1,600 character generator? But it was like there was an eloquent speech as to why we should adopt certain things, and then the numbers didn't add up at the end. So what did they want? I'm still not real clear on what they want and how much it's going to cost and why certain things were left off.
The character generator is proposed to be purchased in the budget for the year beginning July 1. That is not before you tonight. Additionally, the monitor was originally planned for that period. Some of the other costs that you see add up to significant amounts are for the full fiscal year. They're asking for, at this point, the committee $1,500 and the cable TV coordinator $1,869 to get us through and to purchase the things they'd like to purchase by July 1.
So it doesn't include the increase and adjustment from $1,000 to $2,500 for the coordinator?
That would be a budget item.
Okay. And what is their year run in terms of salaries? They're running July to July like everybody else? July to the end of June, I mean? When we say $2,500, for what period is that?
No, the cable TV coordinator runs January to December.
January to December.
And you'd be asked to take action on that recommendation in the budget process.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I just have one comment, and then you people can take over, but I think that all of this should be in the budget process. I don't think we should be spending money every month up here. That's why we have the budget. The budget's coming up in the next couple of weeks or so, and I don't see any urgency.
Any other comments?
Ma'am,
do we have a motion?
Councilor Amaral.
I do think that we build into our budget a contingency fund so that when items are brought to our attention that we feel are important enough to act upon within that fiscal year, that we can do so. And one of our council goals for this year is to improve our ability to use our public cable broadcasting station, and I think that this request of $1,869 is the beginning of reaching that goal of providing better coverage and service over public cable. So I'd like to move at this time that we do take the town council contingency $1,869 for pay for broadcast personnel for public meetings and for minor equipment as requested.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Councilor Timpson.
Typically, I take a hard stand on pulling funds out of the undesignated surplus. In all fairness to the cable TV committee, we discussed this at great length about the need for funds and the need not to draw on this undesignated surplus. And I'm convinced that this is one of the cases where it's imperative that you start to address a concern on the volunteers anyway, that we are not paying them. It becomes a long, tedious night for the operators. And we're really demanding that they be here
more than we initially intended them to be. We have planning board, we have school board, we have council meetings, we have other programs throughout the community. We have uses on the equipment that we didn't anticipate, and that we're trying as a committee to fine-tune these expenses, but it's a tough situation right now to know exactly what our costs are going to be. I'm going to have to support this tonight because I know it makes good sense, and I would only ask that perhaps you also give the committee the support that it needs and approve this.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah, I observed that a month or two ago, we thought it was very urgent to get high stools for these people to sit on, and it couldn't have been too urgent because I don't see the stools yet.
Michael.
Yeah, Council William Jordan also brought that up the other day. What we were looking at and we were hoping was to use some at the library that we thought weren't being used. I discussed it with the librarian. They are, in fact, being used, so we're going to have to locate another source of those stools. You may find that in your budget.
Just a couple of comments. I support this 1869. I think it's something that ought to be implemented and what have you. But one thing I just would like to say, are we paying them $450 because all the other towns are doing it? We don't want to be over and above them or anything like that. Because I was going to recommend we give them $5. A $20 bill, I don't think, is asking too much for them to come out here in an evening. And they're not going to get a $20 bill out of $450, but probably the 50 cents will be in the next year's budget. Is that a fair statement? Thank you. Move the question.
Oh, wait a minute. We've just had move the question.
One second.
Okay, I would
go. It hasn't been seconded. Councilor Latoya.
I guess the only thing that I still have lingering in my mind is I'm surprised they didn't ask for all seven microphones at once, because all the tapes that I've seen rebroadcast, audio has been a real problem. Not that what we say is all that profound all the time, but even if it isn't profound, people would probably like to hear what it is. So it's unfortunate, and maybe there might be some sentiment to increase to $2,619. Which would be $750 additional, so that we could try this experiment on all. I don't see the experiment being a good idea to have one who you may be able to hear incredibly clearly and the other six not that well. And being that it's only $125, I'd like to see the experiment start at once. And we're not the only ones that are broadcast from this dais. Also is the school board and the planning board and others. Thus, I would like to offer an amendment to add $750 to it to try this experiment with the microphones, which is an integral part of the broadcast.
Councilor Jordan.
Well, I think that'd be rather foolish, because if they didn't work, then you got to turn around and buy new ones. If we try one and it's marvelous, then you go out and buy six more.
But we probably can return it if it doesn't work. No one can't fill communications. I'm sure that's the stipulation of which they were buying this.
Councilor Latoya, I think probably the idea is that we try it one, and if it works, then we have the budget. Process.
Okay,
you could include that extra, the others, in next year's budget.
Okay, I don't agree with that, that's all. That's why I offered the amendment, which I don't really hear thundering seconds coming from anywhere. Thus, I will probably sit here alone on that. That's the way life is.
Well, we do have a motion, don't we? And a second. And if there's no further discussion, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor? Opposed? And that's, the figure is 1869. Unanimous? Do you realize that every single vote tonight has been unanimous?
It's good that you bring that up.
Probably we ought to take a break. Doing well.
Never take a vote on that discussion.
No, not quite yet. Item number 55. To consider a request from the Ordinance Committee regarding a review of the Miscellaneous Offenses Ordinance. Councilor William Joy.
The Ordinance Committee met at the recommendation of the manager and the police chief that maybe we should review the miscellaneous ordinances. So we started down through them. We thought we would work on the 12-1-3, new topless bathing, but the committee felt we better leave it alone once we get started.
My subcommittee still hasn't reported back to them on that, but we'll work on it.
So on 12-1-4, disturbing public meetings, no person shall disturb any public meeting, singing, school, entertainment, or it had evening there, and we cross out evenings, so it would be any meeting, whether it's early in the morning or late in the evening and what have you. Meetings of any kind by making loud, unusual noises, by shouting, stamping, whistling, or standing around, obstructing the steps, passageway, or entrances of any building where such meetings are held. What was that?
Do we have any singing schools? Cape Elizabeth, or what is a singing school?
I would presume.
Why did you leave that in? I just wondered. I mean, that seems like antiquated language to me.
Because I thought they had music in the schools, I think was my opinion. But maybe they don't sing over there no more. They used to years ago, but maybe they don't. That's why it's in there, because they used to. We'll follow it up before we come back.
Okay. Could you just read the titles of the other parts of the ordinance?
Just the titles, so that
you want just
a huge audience will know what we're talking about.
You want just the titles of all of them, or just the titles of the ones that we worked on?
Well, the ones that you worked on.
Okay. Turn to the next page. Okay. Permitted fires. This is just for permits for fires and whatever, and we changed the bottom C. Such persons or groups or persons shall use no facility other than provided by the town and shall burn no fuel other than charcoal or charcoal briquettes. However, any underwriter's laboratory, this is what we added to it. However, any underwriter's laboratory listed gas grills or appliances with a gas cylinder of no larger than 20 pounds may be utilized. Gas cylinders between 20 pounds and 100 pounds may be utilized with the permission of the Cable River Fire Department. Firewood may be used only at a fire pit area next to the picnic shelter. That is pertaining to the fort mostly. And 15-3, open hours of the fort. And I'm not going to read it all, but we change the bottom two lines of that to say that lease the premises by the lessee and their employees or agents within the, this is what we added, within the rights granted by the lessee and accepted during the special events approved by the town council. That's to let people stay a little later, I believe, if I understand it correctly, after they have an event at the fort, after closing hours. And that is the changes, and I recommend this for a public hearing.
What day?
April 11th, 1988, at 7:35 p.m.
Is that a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second. Why 35?
We got one at 7:30, we kind of both at the same time. We just split it up.
Jane?
Bill, could you tell us about your discussion in the ordinance committee of the curfew ordinance? And why you decided not to recommend any changes in that?
We had quite a lot of discussion as far as the curfews and what have you, I'd hate to turn it, and maybe he's not aware of, turn it over to the police chief, which I see him hiding in the back of the room there, but I think it could end. But it's a lot about enforcing it, and people, or the children being out after hours and whatever, you know, I think it'd be better if the police chief elaborated on a little bit more.
Chief Pickering?
I thought we were rolling pretty good. I probably shouldn't say anything. I would have opposed changing that particular ordinance, not because it's an ordinance that we use a great deal. I don't recall we've used it any in the last several years. But I think it's a rarity when an ordinance is taken out. I don't recall that happening in the last 9 or 10 years either. It hasn't caused us any problems. I think that it could be a good working tool if a situation arises where we might use it. As long as it's not being abused, I don't see that as having been the case for the last several years. I wouldn't see any need to change it.
Madam Chairman, are you not using this portion of the ordinance? By that, you mean there's no need to use it because we don't have any 16-year-olds staying out after 8 o'clock in the winter and after 9 o'clock in the summer? Or is it not being used because we're just turning our head the other way and not bothering to enforce it?
Every ordinance, as well as every state law, is discretionary. I think that in this particular case, situations like that are happening. I think this ordinance was enacted as a tool in case things got out of hand or we had to detain a number of juveniles for a particular situation. There are state laws in place which would require us to arrest juveniles. I think this is a method that we could use to detain them under town ordinance, which might, for public relations purposes, be much better off than using state laws to either apprehend them or arrest them and bring them to the station.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Torrey.
Is this a local ordinance that was just adopted by a council? I guess it looks like back in 69. I mean, this has no relation to a state law that we're forced to have in this town, right? This is a local decision.
Yeah, that's correct. It is a local ordinance. We pull some area towns. South Portland does have an ordinance which is a bit more technically worded than ours is. Scarborough doesn't, and other communities around the area do not. Some of them have had ordinances, some of them never had, some of them have elected to drop those particular ordinances, but this is something that the town developed several years ago. There's no state mandate that I'm aware of.
Does anyone remember the history of this? Was it a controversial thing when this was put in? Because it would seem maybe in 1988 it would be more controversial, but at the end I'm still going to give a synopsis for people at home, so hopefully we'll get a good turnout for the public hearing, because I'd be really interested to see what the public thinks on this. But according to our law, it's illegal for a person who's 15 and a half years old to take a walk at night. That's what our law states, that it's illegal for a person that's 15 years and 11 months old to take a walk at night.
If unaccompanied by a parent or a guardian, that's correct.
That's fairly incredible to me, even though I understand the deterrence and how it could be an aid. For 1988, that's a fairly incredible statement.
I think these ordinances were written quite broadly and were written by most communities several years ago. I can remember when I was raised in Bucksport that they would blow the horn at 9 o'clock. And matter of fact, at that time, we were home at 9 o'clock. Not sure if that's the case today.
But anyway, I just want the general public to be aware of that that's what the law presently exists in. I hope we'll have people come out to comment on that law. Because I certainly will. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
To sort of answer Councilor Torrey, when that ordinance was enacted, we had a lot of problems. Shore Road, over around the Oakhurst area, with young kids throwing rocks at cars and cans and drinking and raising hell, so to speak. And that was when that was enacted. And I think that could happen again. And that's why I was in favor of it staying on the books. And I guess the other reason I was in favor of it staying on the books is because I'm old-fashioned and I think someone 16 years old should be home by that time anyway.
Do you think they have a right to take a walk on a beautiful night? Beautiful moonlit summer night, 70 degrees out?
If they behave themselves.
So it's illegal to.
There's a lot of things illegal.
Well, that shouldn't be one of them, in my opinion.
I have a question that I'd like to ask the chief. I see on page 12.3, article 4, which is loitering dispersal, under, I don't know what RS, is that MRS? MRSA? Is it a Maine law?
Yes.
Title 30?
Mm-hmm.
It shall be unlawful for any person to loiter, loaf, wander, stand, or remain idle, either alone or in concert with others in a public place, in such a manner as to, and then there's A and B. Couldn't you get at your problem? Then you have your no drinking in public places law. Couldn't you get what you need through these state laws and let that poor 15 and a half year old kid have a walk on a full moon evening in August?
Somehow you get the feeling I've got an army of police officers that are doing nothing but scooping people off the beach. That's not the case. There are a number of ordinances that are in place that, which, again, are discretionary, and we elect not to enforce to that extent where it's disruptive to the general motoring public or people who, as Councilor Jordan alluded to, are behaving themselves. That's the purpose of them. Yes, there are state laws in place. For us to legally enforce state law, we don't unarrest people. We would have to take them into custody, which could be a little bit much for what we were trying to accomplish in the first place. Whereas we could use the town ordinance to protect us civilly and take some action against some people, calling their parents, etc., which might serve the purpose, and we don't have to involve them with juvenile intake procedures or other criminal statutes, which the state law would require.
Councilor Jordan?
I don't think Frank Latore should align the people and fill the hall next time on this, because when we reviewed it with the idea of what the chief has just said. If they use a state law, they're all going to have a record. They can use these and handle it with the parents and what have you, and it gives them some teeth in order to work with, and I think it's a right way to handle it. They get a choice of one way or the other, and it all depends on the times and what have you, and I think that nobody's going to bother anybody if they're taking a walk in a nice moonlight night.
The cat's out of the bag. I'm the one that brought this up, okay? I mean, these two guys wanted it the way it is, and I thought that we at least should review it. And the fact that it hasn't been used for a number of years would indicate that even state law is discretionary when it comes to kids. And that the only thing I asked was that it at least be brought up and aired, and I do think that it's appropriate to take it off the books, because I don't personally believe that you should have an ordinance that is either not being enforced or is there purposely not to enforce. And I don't pick on the police department with this question. I'm concerned about the council. You know, why they would have ordinance review if we're talking about destruction of fruit trees and we bother to take the time to go through it, yet when we see a curfew ordinance that I know my own kids are in violation of, I'm causing them to perhaps have a record, why we're not looking at it. I mean, it seems ridiculous when I can send a licensed 15-year-old to the store after 8 o'clock at night, because technically he's in violation of an ordinance that I had something to do with. Philosophically, I'm opposed to that. If we have an ordinance, and it's a good ordinance, and it should be fine-tuned and kept on the books. But if we have something that doesn't make sense, and true, it could be used, but I think that we do have other laws, be them state, local, or federal, or whatever, that would come into play with any kids, be 14, 15, 18, or 30 years old, that are causing a problem. If they're throwing beer cans, if they're rowdy, there are other discretionary laws on the books that can be utilized. And the curfew, in my opinion, is just outdated. It's not necessary. And it was in the chapter we reviewed, and I just wanted to bring it up for public review. And I think we've done that, and I hope we can get it taken off the books.
Councilor Latore.
I would just like to very quickly and simply say I'm not alarming anyone. I think this is a very interesting issue. We're up here to discuss public policy. We're trying to always get young people involved. We have classroom after classroom come into this chamber. Now, here's one particular one that will affect them. I'd love to hear what they have to say, adults, parents, non-parents alike. There's no question of alarming. Let's look at it reasonably, let's discuss it, and let's vote on it. And I think it's very interesting for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to come forward with their ideas on this. That's all I have to say.
Michael? I would like to make one comment on this. One continuing problem that we've had in Cape Elizabeth is very large-scale parties in homes when parents are not available. The police have very few resources to utilize to deal with those events, particularly when there's just a bunch of kids hanging around. This is one tool that is available to the police department. And I'd be very disappointed, and I think the citizens of those neighborhoods perhaps might be disappointed, if a tool that's given to the police department to deal with situations like that is removed. And I would hope you would consider that when you take final action on this.
Councilor Ammon.
I don't think that this particular ordinance deals with that problem at all of parties in homes when the parents aren't there, because the only ones, that, according to this ordinance, that the police could ask to leave are those that are under 16 years old. So this ordinance isn't getting at that problem. The other thing is, several of our camera people, whom we asked to stay here until 11 or 11:30, we are then asking to go home illegally after they leave and tape and show our evening meetings. So I think we're being really kind of ridiculous in keeping on the books an ordinance like this, which is, to me, antiquated. And I hope we will have good discussion.
Is there a motion? All we are really asked to do tonight is to set a public hearing.
I think we have
a motion. Oh, we made a motion.
We made a motion, and there is a second. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor? Opposed? At this point, let's take a 5-minute break.